I have a vintage black and white television set from 1973 here on my bench. This has become quite obsolete over the years, but it is still good for some experiments. In this video, I will check out whether it can deal with the analog video signal from a laptop's VGA output. Back in the analog days, TV signals were sent as composite video, which means that the three illuminance signals for the colors and the synchronization signals are mixed together into one signal. It was up to the TV to extract these components from the composite signal and control the electron beams in the CRT accordingly. But this process was not suitable for the high resolution of computer monitors. Especially the decoding of the colors was fraught with losses. So most computers and color monitors had separate lines for red, green and blue luminance as well as for the sync signals. Connecting computer and monitor in this direct way is also easier and cheaper because we don't have to make any effort in encoding and decoding the signals. Back in 1987, IBM introduced the VGA standard. Since then, every VGA monitor could be connected to any IBM-compatible PC. The original VGA has a resolution of 640 by 480 pixels, which is close to common TV norms like PAL. Seen in this way, it is at least theoretically possible to display a VGA signal on a TV screen. But there is a big difference though. TVs display video using interlaced scanning. With this mechanism, every frame is split up into two so-called fields. The first field is drawn by the even scan lines, the second field by uneven lines. This effectively reduces the bandwidth requirements of the video signal and so makes the components easier to design and cheaper. In contrast to that, a VGA frame contains all scan lines at once. This means that a VGA signal needs a higher bandwidth and also the scan frequency is about twice as high as this of TVs. Okay, enough theory for now. Let's step right into the experiment and find out how a VGA signal looks like on a 47-year-old TV. Remember that a VGA socket outputs separated signals only. But this kind of TV doesn't have the input lines for them, so I have to break them out. To do this, I must identify the place where the sync signals are separated from the composite signal in the circuit diagram, then cut the connection to the subsequent luminance input and deflection oscillators. And here I will solder the breakout wires for the three signals. In the next step, I cut a VGA cable into two pieces and solder the strands to a pin header. Now I can easily access the VGA signals here on my breadboard. Before I can go on though, I have to tickle the signals out of the VGA card somehow. The way to do so is to tell the graphic chip that there is a monitor connected. The legacy method is to pull some of the control lines to ground, but this did not work for me. So I tried a more modern method. Every second or so, the graphic chip in the PC carries the monitor's capabilities over the I2C protocol. The monitor then replies with 128 bytes of Extended Display Identification Data, short EDID. The EDID block contains all the information about the monitor, for example supported scan rates, resolutions, color model and so on. Scan rates and resolutions which are supported can then be selected in the computer's display configuration dialog. To utilize this method, I let an Arduino Nano pretend that it was a monitor. So I cloned Cuban Coffee's EDID simulator from GitHub. Credits go to this guy. Then I structured the data array a bit to make it more human readable and enabled the 640 by 480 pixels at 60 Hz mode. After uploading the sketch to the Arduino Nano, connecting the I2C and 5V and ground wires and plugging it into the VGA output of my laptop, the Arduino announces itself as a second monitor like a charm. And here is my final setup. I mix the color signals with three resistors and also connect the synchronization signals. The capacitors here are essential because they block the DC bias coming from the TV. Without them, my laptop's VGA chip would possibly be destroyed. I didn't want to take the risk, so I decided to put them in. I turn the TV on, and there is just mess. This is because it works according to the PAL standard, and PAL has a scan frequency of around 15.6 kHz. VGA has 31.5. This is around twice as high, cause there is no interlacing, and the field frequency is also different. But fortunately, these frequencies can be easily adjusted. Let's try this now with the horizontal scan frequency. Okay, this just looks right like Windows, but the picture is still scrolling. So I have to change the horizontal frequency as well. Et voilà! We get two Windows desktops side by side. Sorry for the moire effect and the changing brightness here. This comes from my crappy smartphone camera. Originally, the picture is stable and looks sharp and crisp. And here you can see a test image on both the laptop screen and the TV. The circle looks pretty compressed, more like an egg. But why this? As you might have seen, I changed the horizontal scan frequency only a bit. And the frequency now is 31.5 divided by 2, which is 15.75 kHz. So, two subsequent scan lines of the VGA signal fit into one scan line on the CRT. And that causes this effect. Simply said, you have the straight lines on the left and the odd lines on the right side. What can we do about this? I'm trying to increase the scan frequency even more, but due to the inductance of the flyback transformer and deflection coil, the current through them decreases as the frequency increases. So the image becomes darker and more narrow. Anyway, the highest possible scan frequency I've achieved is around 29 kHz. However, we need 31.5. So I replaced the capacitor in the oscillator for the scan frequency with one of smaller value. Now we can tune it up to the desired frequency. But the result is still not satisfying. The picture is very dark and blurry now. This is because we are now running the flyback transformer at twice its rated frequency. So it produces less anode voltage for the CRT, as you can see directly. But Dr. Volt wouldn't be Dr. Volt if he gave up now. After getting everything back to its original state, I tried a different approach. Looking closely at the specification of the EDID, I found that it contains four so-called detailed timing descriptors. Here we can configure the individual timings of the signal that we want. I did this for a PAL signal, and it took me some hours to find out and calculate all these bits and bytes. Then I uploaded the modified sketch once more. And to my great surprise, the VGA port produced exactly what I wanted, and I got a clear, full-sized Windows desktop on the screen. Even though even small text is clearly readable, I don't think that I will one day prefer this TV over my LCD monitor. But what could be nicer than watching an old black and white movie on an old black and white TV? Anyway, if you enjoyed this video, then hit the like button and share it with your friends. And if you always want to be up to date with what I'm doing, subscribe to my channel and activate the bell, so you don't miss anything. I would also appreciate your support through Patreon. This will help me post videos like this more frequently. And you will get regular status updates and preview videos there. So check it out. That's all about it for now. Thanks for watching and see you in my next video. Bye.